Well, thanks for listening to or watching our sermon today. If you are part of Grace Road, but you missed church service, which we know is a pretty regular occurrence during COVID, we would encourage you to go online to make sure that you are staying up to date on current announcements. One of the things that you may miss are the announced events that are coming. So I'd encourage you to download the Grace Road app where you can find a list of events, or go to graceroadchurch.org so that you can see all the updates and things that are coming. Also, if you'd like to find more resources, if you would like to learn more, if you would like to donate or ask for help or assistance or ask any questions or ask us to be praying for anything, if you go to graceroadchurch.org, you can get a hold of us there so that we can make that connection with you.
And all I have need.
We are going to Luke chapter 12 today. Luke 12, starting in verse 35, and let's pray before we open it up. Father, we come before you, and we are just so thankful for all of your grace in our lives, but also we come before you confessing our continued need for grace. You've given us the grace of your word, but we need your grace because unless you, by your spirit, intervene and apply it to our hearts, these words won't accomplish anything. So we just pray that you would cause your word to be as powerful today as you have promised that it would be by your spirit. We pray that you would use your word to break up the hardness of our hearts, to break up the ingratitude, the unbelief, the sin, the distraction, and our focus on so many things other than Jesus. We pray that you'd speak your truth to our hearts and then help us to joyfully do your will and allow knowing your son to be our highest goal and our greatest pursuit in life. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in his final days before going to the cross, Jesus spends a lot of time teaching his disciples how to live Christian lives. He's forming Christians into a new kingdom, a new counterculture with radically different way of life from people around them, with radically different values. And so far in this chapter, he's warned us against hypocrisy. He's called us to be free from anxiety. He's told us to fear nobody but God. He's called us to have a different relationship with money than people around us. And in today's passage, Jesus is teaching his followers to live with a constant awareness of the fact that he will return and that he could return at any time. We as Christians are supposed to be shaped by the belief that at some point Jesus will explode back onto the scene in world history. He'll come in glory. And at the end of it all, he will judge the earth and make all things new. This truth is called by Scripture our blessed hope. Listen to Titus 2, 13 to 15. It says, we're waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Declare these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one disregard you. So an essential part of what we declare as Christians, an essential part of what we believe as Christians, is that Jesus will return, that he'll appear again in glory. And to deny this, to deny the future coming of Christ, is actually to put yourself outside of the faith. It's to not be a Christian. And we know this because on a number of occasions throughout the history of the church, church leaders from around the world were able to get together to write creeds or statements of like the essential elements of the Christian faith. And in the major creeds of the Christian faith, they all affirm the fact that Jesus will be coming back and that he'll be coming back physically, he'll be coming back visibly, he'll be coming back in glory, that's a future thing that all Christians are waiting for. So for example, in the Apostles' Creed, it says, he suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. In the Nicene Creed, they said, he will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. In the Athanasian Creed, they said, he ascended to heaven, he's seated at the Father's right hand. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. At his coming, all people will arise bodily and give an accounting of their own deeds. So Christians have always affirmed his future literal coming again. Now, within Christianity, there's some debate over the details. You know, is he going to come again after things get worse for a long time or after things get better for a long time? What will the timeline of events be that lead up to his coming back? There are definitely debated issues and there are texts that are difficult to interpret when it comes to what it's going to look like when Jesus comes back. But the essential doctrine that Christians can't deny is that Jesus will be coming back. Now, we all know that there are an awful lot of crazy people who are really focused on the second coming of Jesus. And there have been just tons of people throughout church history who have predicted his coming, they've set dates, and they've been wrong. I know when I became a Christian, it was 1990, and in the years before I became a Christian, people were writing books like crazy about the date of the return of Christ. There was actually a book in the 80s called 88 Reasons Why the Rapture Will Happen in 1988, and it sold a ton of copies. It went on sale in the 90s and didn't do so well then, but there were books like crazy that came out saying that this is the date that Jesus is going to come back. In the last century, just by kind of a quick glance at a Wikipedia page, it looks like there were about 70 prominent predictions for the date of Jesus's return. And in the centuries before that, even theologians that seem very legitimate in many categories for centuries were setting dates for the return of Christ, that this is definitely going to be the date. This has happened hundreds of times throughout the history of the church. So what can happen is we can just eventually laugh off any talk of his return because everybody has been so wrong about this stuff. And online, we know that it does seem like the people who post the most about specifics about the return of Jesus or dates with the return of Jesus, those tend to be people who are sometimes a little bit nutty. And it seems like people who are a little bit nutty tend to be really drawn toward talk of the end of the world. And so you combine that with our long history of botched date setting and fear peddling, and you might want to throw this doctrine out altogether and not have it be like a major part of your thought life, a major part of your faith. But misuse of biblical truth doesn't mean that there's no right use of biblical truth. There are lots of people who drive like maniacs, but that doesn't mean there's not a right use for a car. It just means that some people are misusing their car. And there are lots of people who do maniac-type things with the doctrine of the second coming of Jesus, but that doesn't mean there's no right use for that doctrine. Scripture is very clear that Jesus will return, and that should change how we live. It should change the way we think about God. It should change the way we think about the story of history. So we will walk through a passage today where Jesus talks about his return, And hopefully from that, learn a lot about God and learn a lot about how we're supposed to respond to him and learn a lot about how we should be shaped by the knowledge that he's coming again. So Luke 12, verse 35, it says, this is Jesus speaking. He says, "Stay dressed for action and keep your lamps burning and be like men who are waiting for their master to come home from the wedding feast so that they may open the door to him at once when he comes and knocks. Blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at table, and he will come and serve them. If he comes in the second watch or in the third and finds them awake, blessed are those servants." So here it says that Jesus' coming is certain, and his followers should live in anticipation of it. Jesus is going to come again. This is going to be a real thing. And by the way, it will be clear when he does. There have been some people throughout history who have set dates for Jesus' return, and then when he didn't show up, they kind of needed to save face, and so they would say that he did return, but he returned in a spiritual way. You know, he kind of just like returned in our hearts. He returned in our minds. He returned spiritually by his spirit in our affections. He ushered in a new day. But Jesus taught that his coming would be certain and undeniable. It wasn't going to be a spiritual coming. It wasn't going to be a coming in our hearts. It wasn't going to be a coming that you could miss. He would come and knock, and the master would be at the door. He said this in Matthew 24, verse 25. He says, "See, I have told you beforehand. So if they say to you, 'Look, he's in the wilderness,' do not go out. If they say, 'Look, he's in the inner rooms,' do not believe it. For as the lightning comes from the east and shines as far as the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man." So will be the coming of the Son of Man. So to say that Jesus came spiritually, but we missed it, is to say that there's no future return of Jesus. It's to say that he won't come to judge the living and the dead. And so that's the kind of statement someone would make if they're not a Christian. He is coming. And when he returns, it'll be undeniable. Every eye will see him. His future coming is a sure thing. And so in response to that, Jesus says here to stay dressed and ready for action. Now that phrase, "stay dressed and ready for action," is sometimes translated, "gird up your loins." And you may have heard before that men in those days would wear long flowing robes for just sort of the day-to-day life. But when it was time for action, when it was time for battle or it was time to work, they would take the robe and they would tuck it into their belt so that their legs wouldn't get tripped up on that robe so that they could work. And so Jesus says here that that's to be our posture. In light of his return, we should be active and alert. We should be doing things ready for his return. He says here that we should be like servants who've been left in charge of a household while their master was at a wedding feast. And in their day, wedding feasts weren't as tightly scheduled as they are for us. We know that we're going to go to a wedding. We'll go to the reception afterwards, probably be home by midnight. But in their day, wedding feasts could last for a couple of weeks. And so if this was a wedding feast out of town, it could be a week of travel, a couple weeks of the wedding feast, and then a return home at some time. And so the picture here is that the master of the house leaves his servants in charge of the house, and he says, I'll be back eventually, be ready for my return. And then eventually, he comes back. He comes back at night, and if he finds his servants alert and ready for his return, ready to open the door, he comes in and he blesses his servants. They're waiting for his return, they're preparing for his return, they're expecting it any minute, and they're ready for it when it happens. All the preparations that they're making around the house are all for that moment when he comes back. That's the moment that they're living for. So this means that the moment that we live for as Christians is the moment when we see Jesus, the moment when he returns. I mean, we all have some important moments that we expect in our lives. We have some important moments that we feel like we can sometimes even be tempted to live for. You know, you might want to graduate from college, and that feels like a pivotal moment in your life. Maybe you want to get married, and that feels like that would be a pivotal moment. Or maybe you would want to have kids. Maybe you want to see your kids get married. Maybe you want to retire. And so much of life can be directed toward making those moments good moments. And those things are fine as far as like planning and milestones go. We can wisely plan and prepare for all those things. But the ultimate event that Christians are called to plan for and count on is the moment of Jesus' return when we see him. That's the ultimate moment that we live for and plan for and expect. Above all those other key moments, the one key moment is the day when he returns and we see him face to face. So a quick question to ask ourselves is whether we're living like this at all. What attitudes are being shaped by our knowledge that Jesus is returning? I mean, there are a million examples, but take, for example, our tendency to hold grudges. When we've been wronged, we can kind of feed and stoke that bitterness for years. We can look for opportunities to kind of pounce on our enemies where we can be the judge, where we can be vindicated. We feel this need to sometimes avenge a wrong that was done to us. But if Jesus is going to return to judge the living and the dead, then we don't need to. He'll do a much better job as judge than we ever could. He knows every motive. He knows what's true. He knows what's false. Nothing's hidden from his sight. He'll be the perfect judge. And knowing that that judgment day is coming, that day comes when he returns and judges the living and the dead, that can free us up from having to be bitter. Frees us up from having to vindicate ourselves. Frees us up from having to bring about that moment when our enemy is brought low. Romans 12:9 makes this application. It says, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." So believing that he's returning as judge frees us up from having to. Believing that he's returning, living in anticipation of his return, changes the way that we live. Also, if we believe he's returning, then the decisions that we make should be different. If we're planning on retirement as one of our key moments, that will affect how we save money between now and retirement. If we're planning on marriage or desiring marriage, that's going to affect who we hang out with. That's going to affect what we do socially, what social circles we're part of. If we're planning on graduating from college, there's probably at least some studying happening to move us toward that moment. And so if we're planning on the return of Jesus, we would expect to see some evidence of that in our lives. And we'll talk more about that, but probably at this moment, we're starting to feel some guilt that we've fallen short. We often don't even think about his return, let alone live differently because his return's a reality. And we will come back to that. We'll come back to the remedy for that. But first, let's keep going through this passage to see what else we need to know about his return and how it's supposed to affect us. Luke 12, verse 39, "But know this, that if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have left his house to be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." So now Jesus says that his coming is like the coming of a thief, which means that we don't know when he's coming. Thieves don't call ahead of time and make a reservation. Maybe during COVID they have to do that because you have to make reservations for everything during COVID. But normally, normal times, thieves don't tell you ahead of time when they're coming. You don't know when they're going to show up. And Jesus says that just like a thief doesn't make a reservation or call ahead when he's going to show up at your house, neither does Jesus. Jesus doesn't reveal to anybody the date of his return. Now, this will save us a lot of trouble if we realize this, that the return of Jesus is certain, but the timing of the return of Jesus is uncertain. We just don't know. He hasn't called ahead. He hasn't told us when he's returning. So this means that we shouldn't try to figure out the date. We shouldn't listen to people who say that they've discovered it. We're supposed to live knowing that his return is certain, but not having a day on the calendar that is circled as the date when he comes back. And this will also shape our answer a little bit to the question of how should we be living differently knowing that he's returning. The fact that we don't know the exact date of his return affects that answer. Because if I somehow knew the date, if I knew Jesus was going to return on October 5th, that would definitely change the way that I live between now and October 5th. And potentially in some really negative ways. I mean, I would just start to treat all of life here on earth like it's disposable. I wouldn't be planning for any long-term future at all. I mean, if you knew the date of Jesus' return was a couple months from now, you would probably quit your job and just take out a couple of credit cards. You'd be done mowing the lawn. I would be done trying to lose weight. We'd be done investing. We'd be done caring about politics or government. We'd be done looking for a spouse, or at least we'd be a whole lot less selective about one, because really, I mean, the shelf life needs to be like 6 weeks at that point, so we can make that work. It would really change the way that we make decisions if we knew the exact date of his return. So it's one thing to live like he could return soon at any time and we don't know when. It's another to have a date on the calendar. Those are two different kinds of readiness, and we don't have the date on the calendar type of readiness. So that means living in anticipation of his return isn't the kind of anticipation that lives irresponsibly and that doesn't build for the future. It's the kind of readiness that's wise and good and manages everything he's entrusted to us so well that we are building a foundation for thousands of years, if necessary, but also we know that none of this stuff is ours, and if the master returns at any time, he takes it all back over because it's all his. And then that'll be better anyways, because he's a wise master builder, and he'll make everything new, and he'll destroy all of our failures, and he'll hit fast forward on all of our progress and make everything perfect. So Luke 12:41, it says, Peter said, Lord, are you telling this parable for us or for all? And the Lord said, who then is the faithful and wise manager whom his master will set over his household to give them their portion of food at the proper time? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions. But if that servant says to himself, my master is delaying in coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and get drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him and in an hour that he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and put him with the unfaithful. So there's a few things here. One is that Jesus' return means that we aren't the owners but the managers of our resources. We've said this a bit already, but the fact that Jesus is returning to have us account for how we manage things while he was gone shows that everything that we have was given to us by Jesus to manage well. And everything that we have belongs to him ultimately. So knowing that he's returning and asking us, what did you do with my stuff, means that it's all his stuff, which means that our money is not our money, it's his. It's been given to us by him to do good with and to push back darkness around us. So we use it wisely, we invest it in good endeavors, we give it generously to others who are kind of part of his household. We use his resources to do good. Our children are ultimately his children. And there's a lot that we're preparing them for in life, but ultimately we're preparing them for the moment when he returns. Our number one goal for our kids is not that our kids would get a great education. Now that's a good goal, and that can be part of fitting them for his service, but that's not ultimate. Our number one goal for our kids is not that they would be world-class athletes, though that can be part of good stewardship and managing their bodies and their minds for the glory of God. The ultimate goal is not that they get into a great college, though that could present them opportunities for serving him. The ultimate thing that we're preparing our kids for is to meet Jesus, because they're his. They belong to him. Our houses are his houses. They're given to us to use in ways that he would be pleased with. They're not just a place where we find our refuge. Jesus is that place. They're places that were given to us for mission and ministry, where we can open our doors and hospitality so that people can come in and we can connect with people, and so much of the work of God can be done. Our vacations are good gifts that were given to us by God, and those are times of rest given to us by God so that we can manage our lives well for his glory. Everything is his, and at an unknown time, he'll return, and we will answer to him for how we managed his stuff. Also, you see in this passage that living in anticipation of Jesus' return means that our character matters. In verse 45, Jesus describes the people who aren't living like he's coming back, and he describes them as getting drunk, mistreating others, and they're thinking, well, he's delayed, he's not going to be coming back for a while, so I can just live however I want right now. And so often, this is how we think. You know, we decide to continue in a sin or to give in to a temptation, make peace with sin or complacency, and we think, I'll just repent later. I'll deal with this later. I've got a lot of time. I'm not going to have to answer for this for a real long time. My master is away, and he's not coming back anytime soon. It's been a couple thousand years, so I'm just going to enjoy my sin, and maybe after a few years, then I'll come around. But if he could return at any time, then it matters that we live holy lives now. Listen to 2 Peter 3:11. He says, since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. So we're waiting for that new creation, and the way that we wait is by living lives of holiness and godliness. Paul says the same thing in 2 Timothy chapter 3. He talks about what things will be like in the last days, and all the days from the ascension of Christ till now have been called the last days. We're in those days. He talks about what people will be like in the last days who don't know Christ, and what we should be like as we wait for him. Listen to 2 Timothy 3, starting in verse 1. He says, but understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. So if that doesn't perfectly describe Twitter, I don't know what does. Like that's the way of things in the last days. And he says, avoid such people. For among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jans and Jambers opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth. Men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men. So that's the way of the world in the last days. But then listen to what he says the ways of those who are waiting for his return are. He says in verse 10, you, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. So he says, cling to the truth. Cling to the truth of the gospel that you've been taught. Cling to the truth of Scripture. The stuff that was true in Scripture 20 years ago is true for you today. So cling to that. Rest in that. In these last days, live like the Scriptures are true. When things seem like they're falling apart, when we live in anticipation that Jesus is going to be coming back, we don't tap out. We cling more strongly to Jesus. Also, it's evident in this in Luke chapter 12 that knowing that Jesus is going to return is going to really affect our treatment of other people. Jesus compares the good managers to the wicked ones, and the good managers are feeding the other servants in the household, and the bad managers are beating the servants in the household. This means that treating people with justice and kindness and concern should be the natural thing that we do if we expect the master to return. And this is important because sometimes some of our popular eschatology is a word for the theology of the end times, some of our popular theology of the end times can lead us to inaction here in the world and to not really caring about what's going on in the world around us. You know, the emphasis can kind of be, I just got to get out of here. You know, this world stinks, so let's just kill some time and wait for that day when Jesus comes and raptures us out of this place. I just want to get out of the mess. So then when we think that way, we don't really care about issues of justice. We don't really care about going out as individuals to do good and to work for the good of society and community. We really just want to get out of here. But Jesus says that our cry shouldn't be, just get me out of here, but it should be, come Lord Jesus, come and fix this creation. Come and redeem us. Come and fix the creation that you love and finish making everything new. Jesus' teaching about the end times here shouldn't lead us to inaction, shouldn't lead us to tapping out. It should lead us to really hopeful, sacrificial action. We get on mission to spread the good news about Jesus. We do justice. We build things. We spread the gospel. We make disciples. We want to have this whole household ready so that when the master returns, he says, you've managed it the right way. Right teaching about the end of the world shouldn't lead us to fearfulness, shouldn't lead us to checking out, shouldn't lead us to disengagement with the world around us, but it should lead us to all kinds of hope-filled effort. And that's not because we can fix everything, but because Jesus will. There's actually probably a legend that somebody asked Martin Luther what he would do if he knew that Jesus was coming back tomorrow, and his answer to that person was plant a tree. Because somehow God will take all of our efforts that seem to die and that didn't seem to bear any fruit, and when he returns, he'll resurrect them into something good in his new creation. And I don't know how all this works or exactly what it'll look like, but God is a God of resurrections. He comes and he makes all things new. So the good that we do out in the world of hope, in hopes of making things a little bit better, even when it seems like it didn't make things better, even it seemed like that effort failed and the whole thing died, that could all be resurrected into its perfect form when Jesus returns. It seems like it works something like that. That those efforts actually do bear fruit, even when it looks like they die. I think also in this passage, there's a little bit of a warning, especially to Christian leaders and pastors. You know, he talks about people who are the managers of a household, and they have other people that they care for in that household. And I think the warning here is that the people that we care for are not ours. They belong to the master. And that should really affect how we treat them. If at work the CEO of your company comes in and says, hey, I've got this son, he's fresh out of college, and I want you to hire him, and I want you to kind of show him the ropes at this company. I want to give him his first job here, and I want you to be his supervisor. You would do that, but you know that you would treat that CEO's son differently than you would treat any other worker. You would be extra kind to him. You would give him extra opportunities. You would do everything you could to develop him because you know full well that on Thanksgiving, he's going to be sitting around that dinner table with the CEO, and you want that son to be singing your praises. You want him to tell his dad what a good manager you are. And in the same way, everybody that we ever have under us in the Christian life, everybody that we teach, everybody that we lead, they don't belong to us. They're children of God. And so they're to be treated well. And all Christian leadership lives in light of the fact that all those that we led are to be led well because ultimately they're the children of the King. There's a certain degree to which pastors have been entrusted to the household of the faith. But the people in the church do not belong to pastors. The church is not owned by pastors. And I think we've all probably heard stories of pastors treating people like somehow they belong to them. Jesus describes the beating and the unjust treatment here. We've heard stories of pastors who manipulate, pastors who mistreat, pastors who are over-controlling. They act like they own the whole church. And Jesus says here that when he returns, they can expect severe judgment. He talks about them being chopped up in verse 46. So being a pastor, being religious, having that label, being thought of highly for being a holy person isn't going to fool God. And there will be so-called Christian leaders who on that day are shown to be unbelievers. And we shouldn't think that we're safe because we hold some kind of office. The fact that we know a lot of Bible or hold a certain position doesn't make us safe. It's only the gospel of Jesus that can make us safe. In fact, people who know the Bible and lead with the Bible should realize that they will be more severely judged for living contrary to it than those who don't know it. That's what Jesus says next, verse 47. He says, "And that servant who knew his master's will but did not get ready or act according to his will receive a severe beating. But the one who did not know and did what deserved a beating will receive a light beating. Everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. And from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more." So we hear this, and we should hear it with a certain amount of trembling. And the talk of the end times can inspire a certain amount of fear. And there is a healthy fear of the Lord. There's a healthy knowledge of his return, where we should tremble to think what it would mean if we were not living like he was returning at the moment that he returned. All this should really make us realize that what we do definitely matters. But the hope for us when we know that we've failed and when we can't say that we've been the wise and faithful managers is actually the nature of the owner who's returning. If you go back to chapter 12, verse 37, look at what Jesus says will happen when this master returns to his servants. He says, "Blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at table, and he will come and serve them." That's unexpected. What you would expect is that the master comes home, he knocks on the door, his servants come, they open the door, master comes in after a long journey, he sits down at the table, and his servants serve him a meal. But that's not what happens here. This owner does something unexpected. He comes home, and then he dresses himself for service, and he serves the meal to his servants. He comes to serve them, not to be served by them. And this is our real hope. Our real hope is not that we're going to be able to so perfectly manage our lives that there won't be any thought of trembling when Jesus returns because we know we nailed it and we did everything perfectly. Our hope is the graciousness of Jesus. Listen to what Jesus says later in Luke chapter 22. He says, "For who is greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as the one who serves." So this master who comes and shockingly serves his servants is Jesus. And at the Last Supper, Jesus famously dressed himself like a servant and went around the room and washed the feet of his disciples, doing the thing that the lowest of the servants would do. And then from there, he went to the ultimate of the lowest places. He became the ultimate servant when he went to the cross. He became obedient to death, even the death on the cross, and there he served us. He paid for all of our sins. He paid for all of our failures as managers of his possessions. And the gospel message is that all who believe in him are forgiven and are made as though we've been perfectly wise and faithful in God's sight. Because ultimately, the one who was the perfect and wise and faithful manager of everything that God entrusted to his care was Jesus himself. All the rest of us fell short of that standard. All the rest of us deserve to be cut in two. But the good news of the gospel is that when Jesus went to that cross, for everyone who would believe, Jesus' righteousness becomes ours. His record of perfect service becomes ours, and all of our sins, all of our failures, the wrath and the judgment that we deserve all got nailed to him on the cross. So as right as it is to evaluate our works in light of him returning, remember what Jesus said in John chapter 6. Some people asked him this question. They said, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" And then John 6:29, it says, Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." The most important response to the fact that he is coming as judge is to look to him and trust him. Because we know we can't work our way up to the point where we're going to feel really good about standing there for that judgment. We know we've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But if we believe the gospel that his righteousness has become ours because of what he did for us on the cross, that my sin was nailed to him, we really believe that we're forgiven, then the thoughts of his return, though they'll still inspire some trembling in our hearts, won't just be a cause for fear, but also a cause for hope. Because the master is that good. He was that good to us in the gospel. And when he returns, he will begin an eternity of lavishing his grace on us. So in response to the fact that Jesus is definitely coming and that he could come at any time, we engage hopefully with the world around us. We work patiently. We care about our character. We care about our morals. We treat people well and we pursue justice. But ultimately, we look continually to Jesus. We remind ourselves continually of the gospel because our only hope is not that we could stand before that judgment on our own. Our only hope is that Jesus came and took the blame, paid for our sins, paid for our crimes, and gave us forgiveness and freedom and guarantees us everlasting life. It's not our perfection, but it's his that gives us hope for that day. So let's pray. Father, we confess that often we live for so many key moments, but fail to live for your return. So Father, I pray that you would forgive us for that. We thank you for the perfect record of Jesus, who only always did what he saw the Father doing, who was always doing what was good, who never failed to do his duty, who never failed to delight in the right things, who never failed to live for all the right things. We thank you for his perfection, and we thank you that on that cross, his perfections became ours and our sin was put to death. We thank you for that gospel message, and we pray that by your Spirit, you would apply that to our heart, so that we would live hopefully for that day of your returning, so that our lives would be different, so that we would cling to your word, so that when we see things around us falling apart, we would cling all the more to the teaching that we've received, so that we would treat others well, so we would do justice, so that we would build for a future, knowing that if we never get to see that future before your return, that's even better because you'll come back and make all things new. So Father, help us to be people who look for and hasten unto the return of Jesus, who love your appearing, and who can't wait for that day when we get to see you face to face. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.